Hello again, everyone.
This is a great looking room.
Thank you. As you can tell, we have a special guest here with us tonight, Susan Rice, the National Security Advisor. We are very excited that Susan could join us. She is being incredibly generous with her time to be here. As you might imagine, she has a fairly busy schedule, a few things to do. In the interest of time, I am going to skip over the extensive laudatory introduction. There is a full bio in the roster for the conference. I'll hit the highlights. Rhodes Scholar, McKinsey Consultant, NSC Staffer, NSC Senior Director, Assistant Secretary of State for Africa, Brookings Fellow, impressive position, became U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations, and now you are National Security Advisor. Now, Susan has joined us tonight to talk about the importance of making the foreign policy community in the United States more diverse, more like America as a whole. Given time constraints, we're not going to be able to go into foreign policy issue in the news. We can save that for another time. So I want everybody to think careers, not Korea, okay, as a mantra for tonight. So first question, long day?
Actually, I'm out of the office much earlier than normal, so thanks to all of you. So.
Okay. Well, good. We've accomplished one good thing for the day so far. Diversity in international affairs has been a passion of yours for a while, Susan. Long time you've been outspoken about it. I was reading an interview you gave a while ago before you joined the Obama administration. You said, we ought to have African Americans and Hispanics and Native Americans and East Asians and South Asians and Muslims and Buddhists and people of various backgrounds, ethnicities, language skills, social and economic experiences actively drawn into our national security policy-making world. Tell me a little bit why you think that should be a priority, Susan.
For so many reasons. I mean, first of all, we are a nation that has every element of the world represented in it. And it's one of our, I think, extraordinary strengths. And yet, when you look at the profile of those who are making and running our national security and foreign policy, it doesn't look anything like the diversity of America. It is still overwhelmingly predominantly white and male, although less male, but still predominantly male. And there are very few visible minorities. We have very little religious diversity, which I think is a big impediment. We have very little racial diversity. I look behind me, and well, let me back up and say, you know, I started in this field when I was 28. My first job in government, I was on the National Security Council staff as a 28-year-old director, which was rather young to start. And now I'm add 21 to that, almost 22. So I'm no longer young anymore. But when I was coming up in the field, there were a handful of sort of icons that I could point to who had been African Americans who'd achieved, you know, very senior positions like Ambassador Donald McHenry or Ambassador Andrew Young. But at that stage, we had not had a Secretary of State of color or even a woman Secretary of State. But yet, as I looked at the senior leaders of the State Department at the time, and I say that very conscious. We have Ambassador Ruth Davis here and Ambassador Howard Jeter and probably many others that I haven't yet picked out of the crowd. We had a leadership cadre within the Career Foreign Service that was quite senior and quite accomplished. And so I could look ahead of me and at least see a cadre of people who were blazing a trail.
Right.
I'm now National Security Advisor, and I felt the same when I was UN Ambassador, and I look behind me and I don't see almost anybody coming up.
Really?
and I find it extremely disturbing. And not only disturbing because I don't think it's right, mm-hmm. but I also think it is not how we serve our nation and our national interests to the greatest extent of our ability. We have so many strengths as a nation, besides our size, our wealth, our resources, our military, our intellectual capital, our technology. One of our greatest strengths is our people, and that we are everybody in one place. And if we were harnessing that diversity, we would be making better foreign policy decisions, and we would be making judgments that we're more conscious of and informed by the insights and perspectives that collectively as a nation we have the capacity to bring to bear. And yet we don't. So I am, this to me, the older I get, the more passionate I get about this, because I am deeply troubled that that we are not generating the next and the next generation of diverse leaders in national security and foreign policy. And it pains me as now somebody who has risen high in the field that I have not succeeded in finding enough young people that I can nurture and bring along. I know that President Obama, with whom I was just speaking right before I came, feels this is exceedingly important, not just for national security and foreign policy, but across the broad swath of our government. And we're just not we're not getting there. And I'd be interested in your thoughts and views on why that is the case. I'd be interested in Ruth and Howard and others adding their perspective to this. But despite, I think, some really sincere and well-intended efforts, and I know particularly under Secretary Powell, real push was made, it doesn't seem to be yielding a broad and diverse new cadre, whether in the State Department, frankly, the Defense Department, the intelligence community. And I'll just say, to add one further piece to this, it used to be that the military was producing, through its history and its processes, a more diverse cadre of senior leaders. That is no longer the case. I've had some very important but very troubling conversations with General Odierno, who's the Army Chief of Staff, who's deeply concerned about what's happening at West Point, where the intake of African Americans and Hispanics is going down. And it is barely 5% of the class in a nation which, where African Americans are roughly 13%, Hispanics are at least 14%, and where, the enlisted corps is much more diverse. So this is a problem that I perceive across the spectrum of our national security apparatus. And my team at the NSC is doing some real thinking in our strategic planning directorate about what we can do to try to influence that. But we're looking for ideas, and we're looking for opportunities to give those of you who are coming up the chance to get on this path if that's where you want to be.
We're going to collect some of the thoughts of the audience in a bit, but I want to sort of draw you out on this disturbing trend that when you were rising up, you could look and see people of color who had succeeded. We had Secretary Powell. The gender barrier was broken with Secretary Albright, for whom you work for, Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice. But you're looking backward behind you and not seeing sort of that trend continuing. Can you sort of help us think about why that might be the case? I assume it's a complicated issue. There's no simple explanation, but what would you tell us to look at in terms of trying to understand why, despite a lot of efforts, we haven't had the kind of success that we would want?
I have a theory. Right. I don't have the answer.
We're think tanks, so you're allowed to have
theories. My theory is we have a broader problem that goes beyond the field of foreign policy and national security. We have a problem of attracting visible minorities into careers that involve social sciences, liberal arts, and out of the professional fields. So And I think that somebody can do some homework on this, and maybe this is one of the things that can come out of this, some real research. But I think traditionally, anyway, if you were to look at, you know, a law school class or a medical school class, you would find greater, not adequate, but greater degree of representation, because those were careers where you could move up quickly, you could make a reliable income, you could pay off your loans and debts.
And they had TV shows about those careers that made them a lot more appealing.
But, you know, those who choose to go into the social sciences and liberal arts are basically making an economic decision up front, which is not necessarily the most favorable one. And many folks who take those career paths do end up in academia, although, again, not sufficiently well represented. So we have a serious pipeline problem, I think, that goes back to, you know, youth and comes all the way up to the senior levels. My brother, John Rice, has, in his career, embarked on a different part of this problem. He has started a nonprofit called Management Leadership for Tomorrow. And it is about building the pipeline of, again, visible minorities who are going into careers in management, business, leadership. It can be nonprofit leadership, but also mainly for-profit leadership. And he's building effectively the business school pipeline. And he's found that even in that realm, it is difficult. And there are many different factors. It's role models, it's mentoring, it's preparation, the opportunity to really see that there are others, you know, thriving in the field that you're contemplating. So I think it's a variety of factors, but I think this is not, it may be worse in this field, but it is a problem that is not limited to this field.
Let's talk a little bit about the question of mentoring, and really the question of to what extent do minority professionals face particular obstacles because of being potentially closed out of networks or not having mentors. I mean, you've talked about some people who sort of mentored you over the course of your career. How do we think about that aspect of the issue, Susan?
Well, I think it's critically important to have mentors. My mentors were virtually all white. Mm-hmm. And by chance, I guess it was, and those were the folks that I had most contact with. We talked about Secretary Albright, among others. Former National Security Advisor Anthony Lake, I could name a number of others. I don't think that the background of the mentor matters as much as having somebody who takes an interest in you and gives you a sense that you can do and that you will do and that you have the skills to, and gives you opportunities and gives you critical advice when you need it. So I think having a mentor of whatever sort that is committed to you is critically important. And having people that are willing to challenge you to do what you are passionate about, as opposed to what you think you're expected to do or what your parents wanted you to do or what makes economic sense for you to do. I had the conversation that changed my career trajectory, even though I didn't know it at the time, occurred when I was roughly 23, and I had just finished my master's degree in international relations, and I thought I was going to go, my plan was to go to law school, and I was going to get my law degree and be probably a public interest lawyer of some sort on the domestic policy side. That had been my interest, had been my expectation, and I had just done the international affairs thing to kind of round myself out. And I had a conversation with a professor of law at the time, who some of you will now know is our local congresswoman, Eleanor Holmes Norton. She was a professor of law at Georgetown, and she sat down, took me to lunch, again in a mentoring kind of way, and said, "So what are you going to do?" And I said, "Well, I'm going to, you know, I've got my master's now. I'm going to probably go on to law school." And she said, "Well, is that what you want to do?" And I said, "Well, I'm not sure it's what I want to do. It's what I feel like I'm supposed to do. I need a advanced degree. You know, I felt like my skill set aligned pretty well with law, and in fact, I now think I missed my calling. I should have been a litigator.
You would have been a tremendous lawyer. Trust me. Susan would have been a great litigator.
Anyway, But she said, what are you excited about? And I said, well, you know, I started in international affairs. I have enjoyed the degree I've done. I'm excited about my thesis. I could turn it into a doctoral dissertation. And she said, well, how old are you? I said, well, I'm 23. How long will it take you, she said, to get your PhD? And at that point, I was over at Oxford. And it was about 2 or 3 years. And she said, so you'll be 25 or 26 when you're done. I said, yeah. She said, well, if you're not going to be too old to go to law school at that point if you still want to do that. But she said, how many African-American lawyers do you know? I said, hundreds. And she said, well, how many African-Americans do you know who've gone into the field of foreign policy and national security? I said, very, very few. And she said, well, if that's your passion, you should do it. And you know, it's not, you're not making a choice that precludes alternatives, so go for it. So that was a pivotal moment. I got on a path, and eventually one thing led to another. But that's a mentor that gave me some good advice and helped me to think through a problem differently. And the biggest piece of wisdom that has stuck with me ever since is that you should follow your passion and do what you want to do that matters to you, not what people expect you to do, even those that you're closest to.
You have a whole room of people here that you could mentor. Who would be eager?
I used to do that when I was out of government.
I know, who'd be eager to have you be their mentor, but obviously they don't have the time. You, again, have a few things to do during your day job. But what other advice would you give to young and mid-career professionals about what they do? And wherever you think is sort of relevant, because obviously pursuing a career not only involves choices you make in the workplace, it's about your network. It's also about work-life balance and other sorts of demands.
That's a lot in one question.
I know. That's what I'm going to think
about. So, as I said, you got to do what you love doing because that's what you'll do best. Only you can tell yourself what that is. Secondly, I would urge people to get out of their comfort zones and learn and try things that they don't feel they're good at. So, for example, I always hated math and science. I shouldn't say it, but I didn't feel like I was very good at it. And so I used to try to force myself to take the computer science and the statistics and the even the calculus, which was not a great outcome, and the ergonomics and all of that, so that I was forcing myself to be a bit broader than my gut would have me. So I think challenging yourself is critically important. Helping each other. These are not careers, life, professional pursuits are not zero-sum outcomes, right? You ought to be able to learn from one another, help one another, reach down and pull up one another, reach up and ask for help from somebody else. I don't think that. I think particularly when we're talking about this issue in this kind of audience, we ought to be really supporting and leveraging one another. And I mean the leveraging in the most positive sense. And then, you know, if you're interested in international affairs, the more time you can spend abroad and the better you can be at languages, that's an advantage. I am terrible with languages. Not terrible at them. I actually was pretty good at them. I just never stuck with any of them long enough to be really talented in a foreign language. And I studied Latin for 5 years in high school, which was great for the AP, but it didn't help me too much in my career.
Okay. Fair enough. At this point, I want to bring the audience into our conversation. So people would rise or bring the mic. If you could identify yourself, and remember the focus is on careers, not Korea. And if you could keep your question short, that would be great so we can get as many as possible.
Hi, I'm Sandra Rivera from the U.S. International Trade Commission. I'm an economist there. And as a woman of color, Latina, who has a small child, I was wondering how did you manage to do work-life balance and to make time for your children in this very intensive job? And not just in this particular job, I see from your bio, in every job you seem to have had. So how do you balance it?
I hate these questions because I can answer for myself. But what I hate is the tendency to prescribe for others that, you know, we see in the media and certain best-selling books and that kind of thing. My book will not be about work-life balance. But, I mean, I've been very fortunate is the short answer. For the most part, my kids have been healthy. You know, there have been points where that, you know, we've had a little stressful stuff, but mostly my kids have been healthy. And most of all, I have a husband who is incredibly supportive and competent.
I take it that's a rare quality.
And he more than pulls his weight. So we've actually had an implicit understanding. Never actually, I'd be interested if he were listening to me how he'd react to this. But an implicit understanding, which is that we have not, except for one period, which I'll come back to that didn't work too well, tried to put both of our careers on the super fast track at the same time. We've kind of traded off. My husband is a journalist. He's been a journalist his whole career, mostly broadcast news. He was the executive producer of the ABC Sunday show This Week. When I was in government before, he was working in journalism, but he wasn't at the highest levels. Now that I am doing this, and actually he changed gears when I was up at the UN. We had 2 years or 2.5 years where I was up at the UN. Our family was here. He was doing the Sunday shows. I came home, you know, Thursday or Friday to be with the family, which was a whole part of the week where his job got most intense. He worked all weekend. He had to get up at 3 a.m. on Sunday morning, so like you couldn't go any out on Saturday night. It was just a mess. And so we were both, you know, going full throttle at the same time, and he made a decision to not continue to do that. And so he's now not working. He's not working out of the house. He's taking care of our kids. He's supporting our family and our household. He's doing a lot of nonprofit service and board work and stuff like that. But he's like now holding it together. It'll come my turn, you know, in a few years.
Okay.
And
well done.
Then it will be, you know, my time, as I did when I was at out of government for 8 years at Brookings. I was.
Go ahead, you can say it.
Not working as hard as I know I can. Put it that way.
The pace of work at Brookings is slightly different than when it's at the White House, I think, is the.
But and I've also my parents, my father's passed, but my parents were always supportive and helpful. So I actually, not to coin a cliche, but my experience is it really does take a team, if not a village, to support a working family. And I've been blessed. And I don't prescribe to anybody else because I think everybody's circumstances are different. And you got to sort of figure out what works for you, and there's no easy or simple answer.
Okay, we're going to come to this side of this gentleman right here. Promise I'll go to the back of the room.
Hi, good evening. My name is Haywood Perry. I just recently graduated from University of Pennsylvania, finished up at the White House in Domestic Policy Council. And I was curious about career transitions. Like, how did you manage those kind of key transition points in your career? One example that you already stated was having that key kind of conversation with Congresswoman Norton. But with other transitions, like, how did you just manage those?
It's interesting. I've never had a plan. And I've never had time really to make a plan. So I'll undoubtedly crash to whenever's my last day in this administration and then say, well, damn, what do I do now? Because I won't have had the time or the bandwidth or even the interest to be thinking about it ahead of time. And I don't have a good answer for that except not to be scared of transitions. I mean, I am confident that I can do what I choose to do, that I will be employable, and that, or not, or choose, because for a period of time after I left government the last time, I didn't work for, well, really 8 years, but most.
That's fine. I'm at the Council on Foreign Relations, so you can talk all you want about Brooklyn.
Really not for a good 9 months. And I think it's, I think to embrace change is all I would recommend, and not be scared of it, and not not to overplan, because I think you can get yourself into a set of expectations and prescriptions that bind you rather than give you opportunities.
I think we have time for one more question. We're going to go to the back.
Hi, Ambassador Rice. My name is Angana Shah, and I'm at the World Bank. I want to go to a relatively minor point that you brought up, I think, and that is the question of languages. And especially working at the World Bank, I feel like we have a really big untapped resource in this country, and that's the number of families that come over that speak Arabic natively, Persian, all the national security priority languages, Hindi, Urdu. And you only have about 3 years to make a native speaker, from age 0 to 3, age 0 to 5. And yet I find among Americans, as compared to the diaspora in other countries from these same ethnicities, I don't know if it's a reluctance. In some families, I would say a reluctance. But definitely, there's not as much attention paid to passing the language down as I've seen in the same communities in other countries where I've lived. Is there any thought to trying to harness this resource? You know, if we were short on Arabic speakers in Iraq, but if our population of Arabic descent had raised children to speak Arabic fluently, we may have had more. Is there any thought to trying to increase this, change
really
the approach?
That's really interesting. I don't know, you know, I don't know that, you know, government can't tell families how to.
Not even gonna go there.
How, you know, what language to speak at home, but I think you're pointing to something very significant, and that is that, you know, we are perhaps not utilizing a capacity or resource that we have to our greatest ability. And maybe there is a way, it's something that I will think about as I leave here, maybe there is a way that we can begin to encourage and nurture the preservation of languages in families and in education coming up. You know, we have a very powerful cultural bias in this country to everybody learning English. And if you don't learn English, you know, you're viewed as not part of the fabric of the nation. And yet, and I think parents maybe mistakenly think that it's either or. But we all know through the research on the brain that children can learn multiple languages, probably thrive in learning multiple languages at a young age. But getting families and parents to understand that, to have confidence in that, and to inculcate that at home is a challenge. And you may have parents who have struggled to learn English and are, you know, fearful that they are somehow regressing if they aren't ensuring that their children, you know, are speaking the language, the English language, from day one with perfect fluency. But I think it's an interesting idea. I'd be interested if others have something to add on that, and I'd like to think about what can be done without sort of Big Brother. Yeah. Yeah, but that's about what we're teaching in schools more than what we're teaching at home. As a home thing is what makes it kind of tricky. But yes, thank you.
Now, I suspect, Susan, if the audience had its way, we would spend a very long time.
They get drinks and food out there?
We're going to get them out to have drinks, but we promised to keep you on schedule. So I want to say thank you very much.
You kept me on schedule? I guess you did.
Okay. Terrific.